OTEP community, welcome back to First Frequency of Oneness Shock Metaphysics. It's your bald wonder, Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock Matthews, a.k.a. the Metaphysical Morpheus. And that means it's Thursday, and it's time for the greatest of all time, the GOAT himself, the one that stands 6'3", that makes second frequency bow down and cow down. It's the one, it's the only, Dr. Clyde Winters. What's going on, Baba?
What up, though? What up, though? You gonna play your introduction?
I don't have it. I didn't cue it. I don't have it cued. I forgot it.
All the people that get excited, they're always saying they just love that.
I love it, too. I love it, too. I forgot. I'm sorry. Uh-oh. Yoshi's gonna beat my butt.
You know, but you can only remember so much. You're a busy man. You're a busy man.
Oh, man. Well, again, publicly and privately, I just want to thank you for doing the forward for this book. It was absolutely amazing. The Black AI Jedi is doing some great things, and we're changing lives. That's what we do. It's just been a beautiful relationship, and, you know, the community, you know, has accepted us and as the authority on FBA and FBB, and it's a wonderful thing.
Yeah, and you know, it is wonderful because, you know, it was nothing out there. It's nothing out there like that. It's nothing out there like that for anybody.
No, it's not.
Not even one of a kind. Europeans.
Absolutely.
There's no book out there that's really breaking down how to use artificial intelligence and the programs and what they're all about and how to access them, you know, and you know, you even gave an example on how to form the questions. I mean, hey, damn, that's like you know, I'm going to really tell you, you know, last week we gave a seminar that would have cost somebody $500.
Yes.
Free.
Yes.
It was free. That was a seminar that people who are really interested would have paid the money. But that's the way we are. We want to make sure that we prepare the family to be able to do those things that they need to do. And it's very important. It's very important in a sense that we do these things, you know, because, you know, this is a wonderful time. This is a wonderful time. We have a lot of access to the medium.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's the plural of media. We have a lot of access to the medium. And I think that it's very important that we do these things because, see, you know, This is our news. This is the way we're getting stuff across. This is how things are being produced, man. I mean, let's look now like how they've decided they want to get rid of well, it really hasn't been any black music anyway, because mostly all the rappers, you know, they're all immigrants and shit.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that's why those mumble rappers, you don't know what they say, and they're immigrants trying to fake a southern accent. So yaza baza, yaza. You gotta grow up in that. Gotta grow up, yeah. Know what to do, yeah.
I can't listen to none of that. I've aged out, man. I can't listen to none of that stuff, man.
But black people in general, most foundations.
Oh, that's sweet. Hold on, let me give some shout outs here. Okay, Melvin Reed is back with us. Thank you, brother. We love you so much. You are so good to us. I think it's Monster Shannon. Love you, Goddess. Thank you. Welcome back. And Shonda Lewis, she's from Senegal, West Africa, is in the house. Shonda, we love you. Thank you so much. Madase, All the Way Free is back with us. And, of course, our beloved elder, my beloved elder, PJ. I call her Pamela. I love her. She just sent me an email. She downloaded the book. She says, I can't wait to read it. Thank you so much, PJ. Love you. Zachary Holmes is back with us. Daughter E is back with us. So, you know, I love it that we just have a family. You know what I mean? We have people that we know we're going to see. You know, I can't wait to see, you know, every Thursday. So it's a beautiful thing. So go ahead, Baba. What were you saying?
Yeah, I was just saying that you want to get the news out, and this is the only way we can do it. You know, we don't have any more black newspapers. All the black newspapers, they've been closed down and bought out. All the black magazines, they're mainly owned by those people, you know, if you know who I'm talking about, that they claim control the media. They own all the black publications, you know, except
right.
I think it's an African that owns Essence, I believe it is.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But it may as well be from somebody else because they're not presenting our perspective. And so the only way
there's no FBA representation in Essence magazine at all.
No, it's nothing there, you know.
Yeah, it's no third FBA. Frequency all day, every day. So
yeah, there's no FBA representation anywhere except, I'm sad to say, on Twitter, on Instagram. I don't have Instagram account. My wife, she used to do Instagram. I don't understand all that stuff.
I have a gram, but actually the new hot item that we're getting ready to go into is TikTok. It's you know, my son Yoshi, he's a TikTok genius. So we'll be putting your content up there very shortly.
Man, Yoshi and his brother Quinn, they've got me on the TikTok. They got my stuff on the TikTok.
Yeah, man.
And he said, "You're on TikTok." I said,
"Yes." I'm trying to tell you.
Yoshi and Quinn on Let's Talk, they've been putting up a whole lot of my videos. And Yoshi and put up a lot of videos with me and you and talking about different things. And they're getting good play. But see, you know, Yoshi Mod, he is a media genius.
Totally.
He's a media genius, you know.
Totally. We were talking last night. It's amazing what this. He's a force of nature.
He's a genius, man. Yeah, I mean, I just came out with a hardback copy of my Olmec language, and Atlantis of Mexico, and Yoshi did the covers for him. I'm gonna do a live on Sunday at 3 p.m. Central Time, and I'm gonna do my live is gonna be on the Egyptians and forgot the name of the place. You know, it's the valley. You know,
you got so much content. Now let's talk about genius. Well, you got so much doggone content. You like if Prince was a researcher, you would be that because you have archives and archives. I have no idea how you do what you do every week. And it's you're just a walking library and encyclopedia of this stuff. I mean, like even with today, you're gonna do the black people of China. Who does that? No one. No one has talked about this.
And just think about it, is that a lot of this work I had to do, a lot of this work I had to do on the sly because my wife, you know, she if I would get out the bed, she would say, "Clyde, come up here, Clyde," because you know my. You know, so if I got out the bed, man, it looked like she would know.
I ain't got to worry about that. My baby girl, and I love her to pieces, she's going to beat my ass for saying this. But when she goes down, she goes down. I don't have to worry about her waking up or nothing. So I get up, and after she goes to sleep, I get up, and I'm out here in these internet streets.
And so just to think how much research I accomplished. Have sleep. But the thing is this, is that,
how many years, like the last, what has it been? 55 years.
Well,
cause you started when you were like in 20, your 20s.
I started when I was about 20, 22. So it's been, 22 months. Yeah. About 51 years.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Nobody has those stats. Nobody can catch up and keep up. You're the dude.
Thank you, but the thing is, this is that I was thinking the other day about this guy named Hammurabi. He used to be a man named Hammurabi. He used to go around selling newspapers, and the newspapers would be historical stuff. You know, back when I came out of university. But see, the thing is, this what makes it so good is that I was able to do this, and my wife. You know, my baby doll, she didn't, you know, she always wanted me to stand up for our people. She always wanted me to do it, but not on her time.
Mm-hmm. I understand that.
Not on her time, you know.
Absolutely. Power Inc. is with us. What's going on, beloved brother? I haven't seen you in a minute. Glad to see you.
Yeah. And so then, that's the beauty of it, you know, but, But the thing is, this is that it is so much out there, man. It's so many stories. There's so many mysteries, you know. And it's so much that I want to do, but I have to do it, and that's the whole problem. You know, is that I put the stuff out there so maybe one day they'll do more research on blacks in China. They'll do more research on blacks here, blacks there. I've been really trying to get my Maya stuff out, you know, because a lot of people they just don't know, and a lot of people they really believe that America's the old world, and that really in the Jerusalem was here, and the Jews left from here and went over to, you know, it's so much bullshit. But see, that's because of the fact is that we don't have anybody else doing any research. We don't have anybody else. That's one of the reasons that I really thank you for encouraging me to do the class, you know.
Mm-hmm. Because
now
we got a badass class this time around too. I mean, all of your classes are phenomenal, but the people, man, they're going to do some things on this one. This is absolutely phenomenal.
Oh yeah, and you know, and the thing is, this is that when you count, I mean, we got about what 60? We got about 60 to 70 researchers out there now.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's really interested in
pretty much
and expanding our knowledge and they're publishing their work. Some of them are still pretty shy because I've asked them to publish this stuff, but I need a little bit more work, Dr. Winters. come on now, you can do it. You can do it. And the stuff is good. I wouldn't tell them that their work is good if I didn't mean it. I wouldn't want
absolutely.
You to go out and embarrass yourself, you know.
Absolutely.
And
absolutely.
I know it's so many things I know that you got planned that I can't even talk about, but you got so many things planned that who knows what things could be happening in the future. You know, you say I'm like refrigerator, but
yeah, I can't tell you a damn thing. I swear to God, you can't keep nothing.
That's
you
right.
cannot keep nothing, nothing, nothing at all. So
I just open up the refrigerator and chill the spirit, you know. But you know, today I was listening to O'Shea Duke Jackson, you know. O'Shea Duke Jackson, he has some good stuff. He's in Africa now. He used to be in Europe. He got his medical degree, all that stuff. You know, he's a down brother. He's supposed to be one of the brothers in the manosphere. Well, he brought up a good thing today, and you know, his main thing. He has two things that O'Shea is always talking about. He's talking about one that a person should take responsibility for whatever they do. Mm-hmm. Number two, they should build their own businesses, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He was talking about I think it's Michael Irvin anyway, the football player.
Mm-hmm.
And so back before the Super Bowl, he was in his hotel and this white girl walked up to him and said hello, and he didn't touch her, and it was on film and everything that he did not touch her. He didn't say nothing negative. But then after they had their conversation, she went and told somebody at the hotel that he had harassed her, sexually harassed her, you know.
Wow.
And after they did that, the NFL Network refused to let him report on the Super Bowl. He was suspended. And they said, I think O'Shea said they took him off suspension. And, you know, he got a nice bag. You know, they won't report the bag. He was one of them, I think, for $130 million.
Woo!
But they settled out of court. So he probably got a nice little bag there.
Yeah,
O'Shea Duke Jackson was saying that if he was Irvin, he wouldn't go back to the NFL Network. He would, that if Irvin was really smart, he would try to establish his own program, since he has in a sense some recognition, maybe establish his own program on YouTube or something like that. You know. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are making nice money on YouTube.
Sure.
You know, those that aren't, you know, that they haven't cut off of getting, various monies. But then sometimes people, even if your video is shown, I think you still get some cash anyway.
Mm-hmm.
My daughter-in-law, she has she does a YouTube thing for fashion. She makes nice money every month.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so I was thinking about that fact, and that is that, yes, I believe that Irving could Irving could do his own program, and he shouldn't go back to the NFL. But I know that sometimes people are afraid. Sometimes people like those weekly incomes. But he was talking about that that's like being independent of the white man. And I thought that was kind of foolish. What are you talking about being independent from the white man? I mean, anything that we do on the internet is usually a platform that the white man uses, that the white man controls.
Mm-hmm. Second frequency, yeah.
You know, second frequency. And since second frequency controls, you know, these things in a sense is that how can you say that you're totally independent of the European? I mean, that's just the way it is. If you remember when I talked about critical race theory, people don't understand is that we are still an asset. We've always been an asset. Mm-hmm. The reason that they enslaved us was because we was an asset. They made money. They made money in a sense off of our labor. In fact, the New York City—
not just our labor, also our knowledge.
Our knowledge too. And you know, that's right. And you know, just like they're always selling bonds. Well, they got the word bonds for the New York Stock Exchange from the people who was in bondage.
Exactly.
And it was the black people in bondage who were really the bonds. And so then I just think that's ludicrous to believe that you can run away from the white man and still make money, you know. Now, very important to understand, there are examples of black people being able to make money and white people not having any way to get any of that money through, but that was Rosewood, that was mm-hmm. Black Wall Street, mm-hmm. and anytime that he can't make money off of us, then he's going to destroy it. And so I think it's ludicrous to think that you can be totally independent. You know, the only people who have been totally independent entrepreneurs have been black ministers, you know, ministers, preachers who had a church, because they're the only people who could be totally independent because the people supported them.
Absolutely.
The congregation gave them money. And that's an important thing, I think, to keep in mind. But other than that, we all had to go through Europeans to make any money, I believe. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. What do you think?
Well, I know, obviously, I know a ton of black ministers. And yes, they have a black church. But guess who's running the money? The banks. Guess who they are? Second frequency. Guess who their tax attorneys are? Guess who their business attorneys are? But guess, you know, so it's still one of those things. We're still in Babylon. But black ministers, you know, I'm a black minister. So, yeah, I don't work with or collect any money from second frequency. But my banking institution is ran by second frequency. You know, I in certain situations, I have to have a second frequency attorney to be able to do certain things that my FBA attorneys might not be able to do or have access to. It's still one of, you know, you try to, basically what I tell people is I try to cleanse myself as much as possible from interaction with second frequency. So I basically have a life and a lifestyle where I don't even know where my bank is. They moved, but I don't know where it is because everything that I do is completely transactional on the internet. So I don't have to go in to physically, you know, deposit checks or something like that. And everything else I pay for is all based on, you know, internet based. So it gives me the ability to have lessen, if you will, my racial battle fatigue and proximity to whiteness. But everybody can't do that. But you're right. When Dr. Winter says that we are, and he quotes Dr. Neely Fuller, we're POWs, and so we are given the ability to do what we do. But what I do enjoy, and what I do see, Baba, and we do it, and you and I do it too, is that we're able to use their systems against them. And that's, you know, like the whole AI thing. That's their thing, but we're using it against them because they don't, the reason that they fear, a lot of people, oh, they fear AI. No, they fear us being able to access it the way they do and to get the benefit that we should be getting. And that's why it's an unfair advantage. They fear us coming up and have, you know, the whole reason they had the pandemic and the reset is because people had search engines. They could go and find information out on their own. They didn't need to go, quote unquote, to second frequency to get the information. They could do it themselves. Well, that creates a government of people, a population of people that don't need government. And so they had to figure out a way, how do we reel these people back in so they're under our control? The same thing now is happening with AI. AI is allowing us to be able to do things, to access information and to produce information. This is different. Before, we were able to access information via the search engines. Now we're able to produce the information. And that is terrifying. And they're afraid of their own population, you know, so it's not just us, but it's, you know, it's definitely us. They don't want us to know what we know. And so just like what I go through on my YouTube channel, so I'll give you an example. Now, everybody says, and you said, and I've said, everybody said, oh, you should be at a million, whatever. Yeah, absolutely. I should be. But I take screenshots. They have gone from the shows that we did on Tyrone, the shows that we did on Alabama and the chair, that garnered over 400 new subscribers just within a 2-week period. I went back and they took all of them away. Literally, they took all of them away. And so I take screenshots, and now they're putting some of them back, but they target anything that is black and popular, that when we get quote unquote a win, that's what they do. But I have so many other platforms, and because I know how to do internet marketing, you know, I don't brag about myself, but I'm kind of a goat at what I do. I've been doing it for so long. I've been in the game, in the internet game, since 1998. So I've seen it all, done it all, and I keep up on all of the trends and the fads and all of the things that's going on. So, you know, black, you can't stop black. You know, black don't crack. You can't stop AMA. We don't die, we multiply. That's what we do. So here we are every Thursday for the last, what has it been, 2 years? Going on 2 years?
We're going into our third year now.
We're going into our third year, Baba?
We've already made 2 years.
When is our anniversary, Bubba?
It was last week.
Really?
Yeah, we're going into our third year now.
God. Okay, so there you go. So look at the impact of that. And look at all of the because I was talking to one of the ladies in our class, I won't shout her name out, but one of the ladies in our class, she was telling me, we had a phone conversation. She said, you know, Dr. Matthews, you have no idea. And I've heard this before. She says, you have no idea how many people are watching you, because those views are not really being shown on my YouTube analytics. She says, I have family literally on around the world. And we secretly, she's probably right. She's secretly watching probably right now. They call them lurkers. She said, we lurk. We are watching your show. We'll never comment or in the chat or anything like that, but there's so many people. And I know this because so many people, there are more people who know of Dr. Clyde Winters now because of this union and what we've been doing than ever before in the history. It's the same thing that I did with Kaba. It's the same, the people who I have on frequently all the time, is that's just what it is. And so I don't really get caught up in the numbers. I get caught up in the response, and the people are saying, hey, keep doing what you're doing. You're changing lives. My life has been, you know, I see it in some of the YouTube comments. Some people email me or text me or whatever. You're changing my life. This content is great. Nobody's doing what y'all doing. And that's what keeps me, you know, keeps me motivated and keeps me going.
I knew how I really learned how powerful we were was before Tariq Nasheed did the did the American Maroon, you know.
And
I was really surprised, you know. He knew about me anyway, because a lot of the issues you talk about, it's almost, anyway. But the thing is, this is that it was the family. It was the family, man. Remember the family. They encouraged him to put me in the movie, you know.
Yeah, I remember that.
You know,
that was early on too, wasn't that about 6 months in or maybe
less? Yeah, that was about 6 months in, and they kept on harassing him, I guess, and going to Facebook and all that, saying Dr. Winter should be in, Dr. Winter should be in, Dr. Winter should be in,
Power Inc. That's Brother Damien. He was Brother Damien, I forgot which round he was in, but he was one of our researchers as well. He's out there. He says, I never missed a show. Knowledge is power. Thank you, brother. Appreciate you.
And they were able, in a sense, to encourage him to put me in the film. So I know the power.
There
of
he is. Yoshima. Peace, fam. What's going on, son?
The genius.
The genius is with us. What's up?
Yeah.
Power to the people. So Irving, man, so let's look at it from let's look at some different sides of that, Baba. So, you know, so it's kind of like a situation where you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. But let me try to project myself into, like, you know, okay, so O'Shea, yeah, he has a point. Dude, why would you go back to the people who did you the most harm and no good? I got that. But if I was looking at it maybe from a different perspective with Irving, Michael Irving, what a kick in the face when he shows up every day or however many days he has to be there with them, that he's now in a sense untouchable. He's got your money. You tried to take me down. I came back and got more money, damn near, than I was playing for the NFL.
Right. And working for the NFL.
Right, right. So I got you. And now you got to look at my black ass every single day. And so double middle fingers to you. So that's how I'm thinking maybe Irving is looking at this. And, you know, he had a built-in audience with, you know, so looking at the pros and cons. So the con is, the pro is, it's like he gets to throw the middle finger up, deuces, to second frequency when he goes in. The con is, however, is that, yeah, maybe he could do a brand, his own brand on YouTube and make all the money. But at this point, he ain't going to make that kind of money that he got from that check.
That's
so,
right.
So in one sense, what's the point? And he already has a built-in audience with the NFL. And so if he went on his own, he has to rebuild a brand and compete, in a sense, with what was already established. So I'm trying to look at it from both sides. But, you know, if you're looking at it from the POW perspective, the prisoner of war, you're still in Babylon. But in one way or another, he still won. You know, he really can't make a bad decision at this point. Now, the worst is when you, like, have to apologize for something, but your check remains the same. That's what's happened with, like, Whoopi Goldberg is a great example of that. You know, and she had to apologize and what have you. But the check remains the same. There's really no win. So you're kind of in a weak position publicly, but, you know, you still are the number one, you know, celebrity, you know, on a very popular show. But no, I think Michael Irving, man, shout out to Mike, to Big Mike. That dude, he won. He got a win.
You know, since one of his, since his friend was
what's up, Gerard? One love, brother. My metaphysical brother from another mother.
Right. And just like one of his best friends was Deion Sanders, you know.
Yeah.
And now he's able to go and get exclusive interviews, you know.
Yes.
With Deion Sanders. And I mean, he's the hottest thing in the country, you know.
Oh, Deion, he's another force of nature, man. That dude is amazing. Yeah.
He knows how to make money. Just like a lot of people don't know is that it takes a lot, and I'm not into it, to me, you got to be young to want to go on the internet, because it takes, a lot of people don't know the work. You know, because you've done this, and that's what makes you, in a sense, you know, one of the greatest people on the internet, is that it takes a lot of, it takes a lot of work to put a show out. It takes a lot of work, a lot of persistence, and dedication. You know, a lot of people think that doing this is real easy. It's not easy, you know, and to build up, you know, you don't have over 50 some thousand, you know, subscribers for nothing, you know, but that took years of hard work, you know. And the thing is, this is that, and just,
but see, I don't want to be popular. I you know, I've always said this, Baba, I don't want to necessarily be popular, but I want to be profitable. So I know people who just do it for the popularity. And if I you know, I could do clickbait all day long and probably have, you know, 100,000, you know, views on something, but I don't give a shit about any of that. I'm a scientist, and you know, it's one of those crazy things. It's like, we should be celebrating the scientists, but we celebrate entertainment and entertainers more than we celebrate scientists and teachers. So that's just the way it is. I've accepted that, but I'm not trying to be popular. I'm trying to be, you know, correct, and give the correct information, because, you know, the worst feeling in the world is when you give misinformation because you didn't do the research, you didn't do your due diligence, and now you got egg on your face publicly. That shit hurts. I've gone through that. You know what I mean? So I don't want none of that smoke, because the community, when you get it wrong, family will let you know, yo, dude, you effed up. You know you effed up, right? You know you done effed up. So
that's right. That's why most of the time you had to wait a couple of days before you jump on a lot of issues anyway.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm like, let me get some of the facts. Let me go and take a deep dive into this and see what's going on. And if you notice, it always happens, especially when there's big scandals, that they always, even the news people get it wrong. Even the news people sometimes get it wrong, and then we jump on it and put it out there, and then we have to backpedal, backtrack. I don't like doing that. I don't like doing that.
And that's one of the reasons why, you know, you hate to get on the story too soon, without really, without letting it kind of, you know, die down a little bit and all that.
No doubt.
I was looking at Willie D the other day, and he had a beautiful hat on, and on the hat he's got the chair, you know.
Man.
Like we could buy it, but I wasn't paying it. I was just looking at the hat, you know, so looking at, he's got the wonder chair, you know.
Dr. Elaine Ferguson sent me, you know, that we have conversations where we just laugh uncontrollably and hysterically over the creativity of our people.
Yeah.
And I guess there is I guess you can get a diamond. Somebody created a diamond in embedded chair that you can buy. It's like thousands and thousands of dollars, but it's the white chair. Man, that shit is funny as hell to me. That is just hilarious. But that's our people. We love it.
Yeah, and it's hilarious.
I support all of it.
It's hilarious, but it was a statement. It was a statement. It was a statement because, see, every time you look up, man, is that all these white nationalists always talking about they want to have a revolution. They want to have a fight. We're going to kick your ass. You know, we just want to beat you. And so people needed that chair incident to show that you're not going to whoop.
You're not just going to roll over us, man. You know, we're just not going to lay down.
Yeah.
You know, we're not taking a knee for that. No. We're not dying on our knees. We're going to die standing up. Fuck that.
That's right. And so that's what makes the chair, you know, the chair so important, you know. Yeah.
Absolutely.
But anyway, I'm going to go ahead and
About this before we start, man. Talk to me about what, I don't know how you do this, but the black people of China, you've talked about some of the things like Buddha and all of that. That's just, and you know, some of the origins, obviously, of China and Asia is black. But this is a departure. This is different. This is really a powerful piece. Why did you decide to do this, Baba?
Well, it's a lot of parts to everything. There's no one way to look at things, you know. And the thing is, this is that in this video, I want to go into more detail, you know. I want to go into more detail about why they were Black, what did they do, how do we know they were Black, and things like that. Mm-hmm. You know, just like I'm going to do a presentation soon on the Olmec heads, because I know the names. I know the names of each one of those kings on the Olmec heads.
You've deciphered the language.
Oh, yeah, I deciphered the language years ago, but I was able, in a sense, to find their names. Now I know their names.
Nice, and,
so I'm going to talk about their names, what they did, and see, they found in one of the Olmec heads, they found a tablet. Mm. And the tablet they found had the name of one of the Olmec kings that I had already deciphered their name. So I'm going to break that down. I'm not going to go into that particular king. That's another story. I mean, I got to have some content. Or we'll have to go off.
No, you will. We dying doing this. This is a lifetime work.
the beauty of this is that we're going into our third year. Just think about that. Think about that.
That's crazy,
Dr. Rev Matthews. We've only missed three times out of 2 years.
Wow!
Now going into the third.
Wow! I love it. I love it. I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of us, and I'm proud of you, community. Thank you so much for sticking by us and sticking with us. A lot of you have come through, and a lot of you have left, but the ones that remain, we absolutely love you and thank you. And we give thanks to those that, you know, left as well. So this is what we do. That's part of growth and evolution. We're not revolving. We are definitely evolving, and I'm loving this work and this energy. All right, Baba, it's all on you.
Okay, thank you. Who were the Black people of China? Okay, I want you to join my Patreon. Again, as I tell you every week, my Patreon is going on. I've had a few people in the last couple of weeks join my Patreon. Thank you. I hope you're also joining Dr. Matthew's Patreon. And the thing is that some of the things that I'm doing, for example, this live I'm doing next on Sunday. I'm doing a live on Sunday at 3 p.m. And it's going to be on the Egyptians in the Grand Canyon. A lot of people, the Smithsonian Institution has tried to say that it's a lie. But in this live broadcast, I'm going to show you the evidence that proves that there really was Egyptians in the Grand Canyon. And you're going to be, I hope you guys are tuned in to that on Sunday at 3 p.m. Central Time. But please join my Patreon. Is one of my Patreon followers who encouraged me to do this. So I'm very excited about it. The slides from this presentation and all my presentations on every platform that I've done, you're going to find them on my Patreon. And I've done a lot of presentations on a lot of different platforms, and you're going to be able to find all of those slide presentations on my Patreon. Join my Patreon. Help me to be able to continue this good research, because I'm telling you, these things cost money. You know, some of these books cost $200, and I'm disappointed sometimes when I buy the book, but I have to buy the books so I can make sure that I bring to you the latest research out there. You know, often I write a PDF. I didn't do a PDF on this. But I could have, but I, you know, that's another story. You can go to YouTube. I have 240, over 200, documentaries on all aspects of Black history. These videos, in a sense, break down every aspect of Black history. In fact, it's from my YouTube channel that I'm going to do my live. And I hope that you'll join me. And go to my YouTube channel. You know, subscribe. That way you can keep up with any new video, any new documentaries, videos that I put out. Okay, you can buy my, I'm at Twitter, Dr. Clyde Winters 8. Every now and then I put something on Twitter, you know. And you can order my books on Amazon.com. And they're very important. And I'm very thankful that you guys support me a great deal. Yes. I'm happy that you guys are buying my books. You're spreading my word. And it's very important because, see, it is so much. I mean, I wish I didn't have to write all these books, but the reason I'm writing all these books is that it's so much of my history that people don't know about. Right now, I'm working on a book on our Aboriginal ancestors. You know, there's so many lies out there. You know, so many people are now talking about that America is the real Middle East, that the Mississippi River is the Nile. You know, they talk about the fact there's a lot of places in the United States called Memphis, Luxor. Those are Greek names, man. Those are Greek names of Egyptian cities. They're not Egyptian names. It's so silly. And yet, when you have people, in a sense, who don't know how to do research, and people who are following people who don't know how to do research, it's a shame, you know. Like, I saw a video the other day, and it's talking about the surnames of the Black Indians. And then, you know, I looked at the video, it didn't have nothing about any surnames. But hey, it got a lot of views, about 15,000 views. But the thing is, this is that so, but people, in a sense, people, I don't know why, family, people love a lie. But the wonderful thing, family, is that you come to this, you come and be with us every Thursday. You share this time with us every Thursday. And this motivates me. It motivates, you know, Reverend Dr. Shock. I mean, Reverend Dr. Shock, this man is on fire. He's writing books because, in fact, family, you guys are encouraging him. You're encouraging me. You're making us want to put the light out there. Turn on the lights.
Absolutely, 100%. 100%.
Shit, give me my sippy cup. Damn.
It's time for your sippy cup and your pills and PJs early. It's like, it's about 41 minutes in. So, yeah, that's about right.
Yes, sir.
It's time for you to go.
I'm not going
to
put on my stockings. I'm not
going to
No,
we don't want you to do that. Oh, you ain't got no sense. No, you see what I have to deal with, family? Go ahead on now.
Yes, sir. So buy my books at Amazon. Okay, also, somebody has set up a fake Facebook account, and they're asking a lot of people to join. This is what they're sending out. If you look down in the right-hand corner where it says 41M, you can see where they got Peppy on it. That's Peppy, and Peppy the Frog is that's a sign of racist. And so some people are pretending to be me. So if anybody asks you for some money.
Wow. Talk right. about if we are not getting out there. They're now Second Frequency is trying to go in. Oh,
yeah, that's Peppy. Look, that's the Frog Peppy. You see the red, and you see the green, the green, the blue, right where 44-1M. And I find it very interesting
wow.
that they put Peppy at the bottom of this fake emblem.
Pardon my French.
Right, to try to pretend that they're Clyde winners. You know, some people have, like, they sent this today to my granddaughter. And my granddaughter said, what the hell, why is somebody PMing me on Messenger when my granddad could call me anytime? So this is what
wow.
they said. And so then anybody out there, if you get somebody out there claiming, I'm going to contact Facebook, but if you get anybody out there saying that Clyde winners are asking for money, they're asking for you to buy merchandise, anything like that, it's not me. It's not me. You see, it's
wow.
not me. The only place that I mention my books or my videos and things like that. And I'm not asking anybody for money. You know, you can join my Patreon, but my Patreon, not some fake or whatever. But again, I just found it very interesting that this fake picture to go along with this fake site has Peppy down at the bottom. But again,
well, the other thing you could also do is like, okay, sister, you know, it's only so many shows you do. You do my show, my platform, Sister Shanice, and there's a couple of other brothers
yeah.
that you're on. So that's the only, you know, if you don't see him, don't go and do it, because that's the only thing he's going to do. You know, every week it's the same thing. It's consistent.
Yeah.
But this is what they do. Wow, these sons of itches.
Yeah.
But you know, the positive is you are pissing off. We are pissing off Second Frequency, and they can't knock it, and they can't knock the shock, baby. You can't knock the shock. We skyrocket like a rocket because this
uh-oh.
Is what we do. This is what we do, and this is letting you know that it's penetrating. It's harmful to them. You know, just to see Black science and scientists doing what we do, making known the unknown, making visible the invisible, that's an act of AMA. We are all acts of AMA. Yeah. So now we have moved over to that side, if you will, where, you know, second frequency is now trying to, you know, infiltrate and make money off of us. Fascinating. Thank you for that, Doc. I didn't know that.
Yeah, I just found out today. Well, I know somebody else had mentioned something last week, but I just found out today because I was saying, how could they be pretending at me? But then you can see they've got a site somewhere, and then you know, your friends on Facebook, all that old bitch.
Wow.
So again, if anybody on Facebook is claiming to be me, I'm not asking for new friends. I'm not asking you to be my friend. The only reason that I got 799 friends, and I love every one of them, is because of the fact that when I got on Facebook, I only had a few friends. And then somebody said, "Hi, you're supposed to be so important. Why don't you have more friends?" Then I just started really, you know, contacting my friends around the world, in India, my friends in the Sudan, and in Egypt. And then boom, before you knew it, it was 799. But the thing is, this is that it's very important to understand is that people are there because they know that that's how people are getting the news. It's sad to say that because we have no newspapers, we have no magazines. A lot of the news that Foundation of Black Americans is getting is through Facebook, Twitter, or X, and Instagram. It's really sad, you know, but that's where it's got to be, you know.
Absolutely. Thank you for that.
Yeah, and also I hope you'll find my buy my book Pathfinder, Clyde Winters in Search of the Roots of Afrocentrism, a memoir. This is my memoir. In this book, I talk about how I became a researcher. I talk about my life. You know, you can see some of my pictures. You can see how I started out a little yellow nigga, then I got dark. The older I got, the smarter I got, the darker I got. I know. You know, I was
walk away, Clyde. Walk away from it.
I was like a raisin. I was like a raisin. When I was that young nigga, I was looking yellow like my daddy. As I got older, I started looking black like my mama.
This is what we got to deal with, family. This is what I'm talking. It's real. He doesn't take his medications. I don't know why he doesn't do that.
That's that Choctaw shit. You know, because. You know, my father, you know, he light skin, gray eyes, all that type of shit. So then I had to get more of that chaka. Warpath.
We're gonna get letters.
Please only send letters. The letters.
Views and opinions expressed on first frequency and oneness. Not necessarily.
But I hope you guys will buy my book Pathfinder. I talk about my life. I talk about how I got to be a researcher. And it also tells you how you can be a researcher and some of the steps that I took to be a researcher that you can take to be a researcher too. So, you know, you'll find this pretty good reading. Most of the people who've read it, they said they liked it. So try to get my book, Pathfinder, Clyde Winters in Search of the Roots of Afrocentrism. It's my memoir about me. Okay. Also, Sister Shanice, this is our new advertisement. Sister Denise has made a beautiful advertisement for a show. I love this. It is so beautiful, you know. And it's Sister Denise's show, African News, Interviews, Reviews. Check out her show. And, you know, this is just wonderful how she put this together, this advertisement. You know, it is so
I'm getting ready. I'm going to have her on our platform soon.
Okay.
Yeah, she's got to come on. I'd love her too much. She's changing the game.
That's right, and I mean,
she's a force, you know, of nature. I love that. That looks beautiful.
Oh yeah, it is beautiful. You know, she's my oracle because sometimes Shanice, she can say something, and it's you know, she can say something and you may think it's innocent, but it can send you on a journey because you know, she has a lot of good intuition. And she tells you a lot of good stuff. And I hope people will, you know, support her. And this is just a beautiful site. Also, the brothers at the Swarty Nerd podcast, they did a show on me a couple of months ago. And then a lot of people who saw the show, they had questions that they wanted me to answer. And so the latest Sporty Nerd podcast is called, The Return of Dr. Winters. Where did Caucasians come from? If you look at this podcast, I explain how white people originated. I also explain how our Aboriginal heritage was stolen. So, try to check out Swarthy Nerd podcast. Where do Caucasians come from? You'll find it interesting. FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, ancestry, or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. I'm talking about Blacks in China. If you want to find out more, you can get my book, The Ancient Blacks of China, and also my book, The Ancient Black Civilization of Asia. If you buy these two books, you'll get a very good idea about the Black people in Asia. I've been updating this over the years. I haven't really updated everything because, see, most of the latest stuff I put in my videos, So, again, if you look at the videos, I know we've done a video or two on ancient China here, and that has a lot of the latest stuff. I try to make sure in the sense that I keep up with the latest stuff, but I don't want to just keep on revising books over and over again, because as I try to tell you that knowledge is dynamic, research is dynamic. There's new research taking place every day. And because there's new research taking place every day, you can't always keep up with the latest news, and you would be revising the book every year, every week, maybe, because there's so much research that's taking place, because it's a lot of money out there for Europeans to do research, the Chinese, even though the Chinese, they lie. The Chinese, they lie about their history. They try to make it seem as though they've always ruled China. No, you're all full of shit. Now the Chinese, they're very prejudiced against African people. If you go to China now, when they go on the beach, they don't go on the beach to suntan. They try to cover up their face and cover up their skin and try to get under umbrellas because they don't want to get dark. Because just like everybody else today, they want to be a pseudo-European. They want to be second frequency if they can. And if they can't, in a sense, be entirely, second frequency, they do want to have that pale color. But again, if you want to find out more about Blacks in China, get my book, The Ancient Blacks of China. You can get it at Amazon.com and The Ancient Black Civilization of Asia. These books will explain you about the Elamites and Black Chinese. Li Min, the Black People of China.
My bad. So what people founded the
Shia.
The Shia dynasty.
Okay, I'm sorry. It's been a long time. Huangdi. The Chinese legends designate various culture heroes as the inventors of various aspects of Chinese civilization. The Chinese term for emperor is Di. Huangdi, the Yellow Emperor, is a Chinese culture hero credited with introducing boats, carts, the bow and arrow, ceramics, wooden houses and writing. The country west of China was Elam, and this is where Huangdi is supposed to come from, and this is Huangdi who introduced the chariot. The cultural hero Huangdi is the direct link to Africa. His name was pronounced in Old Chinese Huahaiwandi, Huanagondi, or Kunte. Kunte is the name of a Mandi-speaking clan in Africa. He was supposed to have arrived in China from the west in 2282 BC and settled along the banks of the Luo River in Shaanxi. Some Chinese scholars have claimed that Elamites may have played a role in the rise of Chinese civilization. Much of what we know about Elam comes from the Akkadian sources. Su Kao Ma period, 1900 to 1500 BC, had named Singla the king Nahunti. The rulers during this period is called Sukauma, because the rulers of Elam were called Sukauma, or the Grand Regent. The Elamite title for king was Sunkir, During the Sukauma dynasty, Kutur-Nahhunte conquered southern Babylonia. The name Kutur-Nahhunte would correspond to Chinese king Nahhunti, a Mandi named Kunte among the Mandi-speaking people. It's interesting to note that Malinke Bambara and the Lamite languages are genetically related. You know, if you saying to yourself Kunte, that's very familiar. Yes, Kunte is very familiar because Alex Haley, when he wrote his book, he said one of his ancestors was named Kunta Kinte, and see, Kunta is a clan name of the Mandi-speaking people in West Africa. You know, in addition to finding black skeletons in China, we also find that Mandi or Malinke Bambara language is a substratum language of Chinese. When I talk about a substratum language, that means that you have, in a sense, the Chinese language, but when you look at some of the words and some of the words that are part of that language, you can see, in a sense, that many words in the Chinese language come from the Malinke Bambara or the Mandi languages. The Malinke Bambara loan words in Chinese include kinship and culture terms. For example, in Chinese, they have the word da, which means great or noble. In Malinke Bambara, they have the word da. You know, for child, we have di in Chinese, and di in Malinke Bambara. In Chinese, the word for grand is ban. In Malinke Bambara, the word for grand is ba. The word for big is da in Chinese, which is yeah, in Malinke Bambara. The word for cow in Chinese is niu. And cow. And the word for cow in Malinke Bambara is ni, or house. The word for house in Malinke Bambara is lu, and in Malinke Bambara is lu. You can find all these words. You can find them in my book. Not my book. You can find them in a book called A Survey of African Music. And in this particular book, they publish many of the other words that relate to Malinke Bambara in Chinese.
Here's what I found.
So the thing is, this is that you can get that information, and that can just get this book, African Survey of African Music. And in this book, it has, I give a greater list of many of the words in Chinese and the Malinke Bambara language. So, you know. Okay. Also, you'll find, in a sense, that the Chinese on their oracle bones. The oracle bones were bones, in a sense, that the Xia people and the Shang people wrote many messages many messages that relate to their language. And as you can see, the letters on the Shang on the oracle bones on the left side, they relate to the Mandi script. When these signs that I label as Mandi script, that comes from, in a sense, the so-called Vi script, you see. And then if you look on the right-hand side, you can see that the megalithic pottery of South India, the Indus script, the Egyptian pottery signs, the Mandi script, and then Anatolian signs. If you look on that right-hand side, you can see how many of those signs are identical. In other words, back around 2000 BC, you know, black civilizations were using the same writing systems throughout the black world. See, remember, in a sense, is that Europeans are always trying to tell you that black people are an oral people. Yes, we do. We do, in a sense, love or mean, or we do love, in a sense, telling our stories, orally. But at the same time, we are very literate people who have always had writing. Yes.
Hey, Doc, can you turn that music down in the background? I know you have it playing. Can you turn that down, Baba, so we can hear you? Thank you so much.
I'm sorry. I didn't know it was that loud.
No worries.
Okay. The second great leader of the Xia dynasty was Qi, the son of Di. Di is the Chinese word for emperor. It comes from the Mandingo word Da, but Di means emperor. Same thing in Mandingo. According to the Kuban Zhu Shu, Yeah, the Xia dynasty had 17 kings and lasted 471 years. The Xia people spoke a Mandi language. This indicates that the founders of the Shia dynasty may have been members of the Sioux Empire. And again, I showed you earlier those words from the Mandi language and also the writing. So you can see how the Shia people, these ancient Chinese, they weren't necessarily, in a sense, you know, they had, in a sense, an African identity. You know, I really learned about this whole idea about Africans and West and Chinese back when I read this book, The Man Who Cried I Am. In this book, the author talks about the fact is that in West Africa, many of the people made the same straw hats that are worn by people in China. And if you go to Gambia, you'll find that many of the people in Gambia, Nang, Yang, Qing, a lot of people in Gambia have a Chinese sounding surname. So it's very interesting. But again, that's mainly because the fact is that you have to look at it from this perspective. Is that, see, just because Black people are only in Africa today, that wasn't where they always just stayed. You know, we were not, in a sense, a people who just stayed in one place. We built ships. We sailed around the world. We made voyages throughout history. And yet they tried to, in a sense, make you believe that Black people are land lovers, that Black people only, in a sense, like to stay in Africa, and that they never voyaged out. But that is a myth. You know, Kemet, the name of Egypt, was not the only African civilization 4,000 years ago. There was another great civilization in Africa called Sioux. Although the capital of this empire was centered in the Nile Valley, Sioux extended into Asia. Yes, yes, yes. Elam, and also the Shia dynasty were probably part of the Sioux. Get this book, History of the Sioux Empire. In History of the Sioux Empire, we tell you the history of the Sioux Empire and the Mandi-speaking people who founded this gigantic empire. The term Sioux comes from adding a U, Sioux, to make the term plural. An early king of Sioux was Sheshi. Sheshi ruled for 19 years, and this is in the Nile Valley. It appears that his authority extended to the Hyksos, Kushites, and Lower Egypt. Sheshi was married to a Nubian named Tadi. Their son was Nahisi. After Shin Xie's death, the throne was given over to Pharaoh Nahise Asere. The theocratic center of Sioux were Phile and Umbo. The texts of Nahise have been found in Nubdi Okasi, Mendes, and Sas. The name for Sas in Meta Nature was Sau. The capital of the Sioux Empire was Umbo. So it's very important to understand that this is one of the reasons why. You see, Black people have taken it for granted that Europeans know everything about Egyptian history. You see, they take it for granted that Europeans know everything about Egyptian history. But most Europeans, the Egyptologists, they never talk about the fact that there was also a secondary empire in Egypt that was expanding all the way in Asia. And this was the Sioux Empire. And the most important thing to remember is that the Pharaoh Nahise of Egypt was also the emperor of the Sioux Empire. And the Sioux had many, many corresponding nations in Asia. This is Umbo. This is the center. This is where the main Sioux religious temple. The Sioux people worshiped a number of gods, including Set, Neith, and Benebdiet. Benebdiet was a unifying god for the Sioux because this god was the spirit of Geb, Osiris, Re, Ra, and Shu. The major center for Benebdiet worship was Mendes. Phile was the symbolic seat of the Kushite high god. The Mandi people called the goddess Neith Nia. The most famous king of the Second Sioux Empire was Nahesi. King Nahesi was the son of Sheshi. Nahesi was also a 14th century dynasty king of Egypt. Yes, 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 yes. Nahesi was the king of Egypt, Pharaoh of Egypt, but he was also, in a sense, as I tell you, he was the emperor of the Sioux dynasty, the Sioux people who had civilizations outside of Egypt. Yes, we do not know all of Egyptian history. We need people to stop this bullshit. You know, so many Black scholars, They don't do their own research. They don't do their original research. So they don't know anything about these empires that existed in Africa. Empires that were, in a sense, co-empires with ancient Egypt. Stop it. Study. The throne name of Nehisi was Ak-Ahseri. Steles of Nehisi have been found in Tel el-Mukhdan, Tel Abuwa, Tel el-Dahaba, and Tajaru. Ancient Tajaru. Nehisi made many offerings to Ben-Abdiad. So these are some of his stellars, in a sense that tell us that have his name on it, and also show that his influence, you know. They've also found stelas of Nehisi in the Levant. See? Among the Phoenicians. You know, he's also mentioned in Indian literature. Nehisi was loved by people from Kush to Canaan. Dr. Srinivasan makes it clear that Nehisi was a Sioux king. Srinivasan made clear that Nehisi was called Nahusha. Nahusha in Indian literature. Yes, yes, yes. See, that's one of the greatest things I think that I really like about Dr. Lenny Srinivasan's work. You know, she's written three beautiful books. And what she's done is she's been able to show that much of this ancient literature that we think is about India is not really about India. It's really about the Nile Valley, you see. And so then we need to put all of this evidence together. And that's what I'm trying to do. Put all of this historical documentation together so that we can have a fuller view, a better understanding of our ancient history. You see? Europeans don't know everything, but you have to do the research. The leaders of the Sioux Empire were predominantly Mandean-speaking people. Their name, Sioux, came from the Mandean word Si, which meant black, people and nation. Thus, the addition of a U to Sioux to make plural gives us the word Sioux. They were centered at Umbo. The Xia civilization of China and Elam were part of the Sioux Confederation. The Sioux who founded and belonged to the Sioux and Elam nations were Mandean speakers or Si. It's very important to understand this is that a lot of, in most ancient African empires or black empires, they were mainly confederations or they were federal states. They were states in the sense that they recognized an emperor as a supreme ruler, but there was a lot of leeway for, in a sense, the local kings and governors. They had also authority, even though they recognized, in a sense, the supremacy of an emperor. That's why Nehisi in Umbo in Egypt was able in Umbo, and Umbo was also called Kasu. But anyway, at Umbo, you know, Pharaoh, Nehisi was able, in a sense, to also influence politics in Elam and in the Xia Empire in China, you see, because they were all, in a sense, part of this confederation where they recognized, in a sense, Nehisi as the emperor, but they also, in a sense, recognized that they were part of this federated state. The first capital of Xia was Yangxing. This city was in southwestern Shaanxi. Archaeologists believe that Daoxi and Wangxingyang may be Xia cities. Daoxi dates to 2500 to 1900 BC. Here the people raised oxen, pigs, and sheep. They grew millet. Their homes were built halfway below ground. They smelted copper. The coral dragon motif is common at this site, along with crocodile skin drums. You see, it's very important to understand, if you notice, in a sense, in much of China today and in the second frequency world, they grow wheat. But as you can see, when Asia was a black continent and black people were ruling Asia, they didn't grow wheat, they grew millet. Emperor Shun appears to have given Egyu, his son, the principality of Shang, and Yue, the principality of Xia. After the death of Shun, Yu became the leader of the confederation of Xie Hixin, the large Guos of Xia and Shang. According to Gu Xiu Yu in the Du Sheik Fang Yu, Xian Yao, written in the 1600s. The second greatest leader of the Xia dynasty was Qi, the son of Di, Emperor Yu. According to the Guban Zhu Xu Xian Yan, the Xia dynasty had 17 kings and lasted 471 years. The Xia dynasty remained strong until the tyrant Jiek came to power in 1766 BC. Jiek was deposed and exiled by Xiang Yang, ruler of Shang. There are 30 references to the capital of Xia in the Zhao Zhuang Guaiwu and Guban Zhu Shu Jiek Nian. Luoyang Plain in central Henan, especially the region of Dianfeng and Yuxian in the upper Yin River Valley and the area near the Fenhe River Valley in southwestern Shaanxi, south of Mount Hua, are usually mentioned in these sources as the area where the Xia capital was established. The Chinese history tells us much about Xia. According to our Chinese tradition, the Xia built their settlements near rivers, lakes, and streams. The Xia dynasty is mentioned in the Oracle Bone records. The leaders of Xia were granted rule based on the Xu clan. See, we see Su again. Su clan membership. The Xia naming system employed the 10 celestial stems, the same as the Shang people. The Su clan goes back to the Su tribe of the Lamb and the Su Empire, which was centered in the Nile Valley. You see how, in a sense, is that it's these little tidbits. It's these little tidbits that relate to ancient history, see. But unless you get a thorough reading, a thorough knowledge of ancient history, you can't put this stuff all together, you see. That's what makes, in a sense, extensive reading of our history will help you to understand better. You know, just think about Marie Childs. If it wasn't for Marie Childs and her ability, in a sense, to decipher this ancient history of Europe, we wouldn't have even known that Europe was a black continent to the extent that it was. The Danes, the Vikings, all these things have been discovered. And see, it's just like when I found out about the Sioux Empire. I found out about the Sioux Empire by not just reading, in a sense, European history about Egypt. I found out about the Sioux Empire by understanding that there were Sioux in Elam, by understanding that there was Sioux in China. And then by comparing the languages, I found, wow, that many other terms in Elamite or Old Persian. Elamite is numbered Old Persian. That's the original language spoken by the Persians. But then I found that the terms had a genetic relationship with the Mandy language. You know, the Xia language spoken by the Chinese, they had a genetic relationship. When I say genetic relationship, I'm not talking about genomes, that is these physical characteristics that you find in the blood of people. I'm talking about when I talk about genetic relationships and relationship to languages, a genetic linguistic relationship means that the people who speak these languages not only share vocabulary, grammatical features, and things like that, it means also that they come from a mother culture or a mother civilization. That's why they say a linguistic relationship that is a genetic linguistic relationship is a family relationship that goes back to the fact that they had a common ancestor that led to the people who speak these languages. The Chinese, they used, the Chinese had red and black pottery just like in Africa. Johannes Gunnar Anderson found red and black pottery in China. The black and red ware, BRW, coming to the Fertile African Crescent, was also used in China. There's affinity between the BRW from Nubia and the pottery from Yangzhou sites in the Henan, Gansu sites of China. Here you can see a Chinese red and black pottery, and you can see the Egyptian type red and black pottery. And you can see these similarities because they came out of the same culture. Because remember what I told you is that the Su clan of China, which founded Xia, is related to the Su clan that was part of the Su Empire in the Nile Valley. You got to get my book, The Su Empire, if you want to find out more about this great ancient black civilization that people don't know about until now because of intensive research and reading all these documents. The Africans or Blacks that founded civilization in China were often called Li Men, Black people, by the Yao dynasty. This term has affinity to the Sumero-Akkadian term Sagiga, black-headed people. These Li Men are associated with the Chinese culture hero Yao. In the annals of the bamboo books, we learn that Yao devised a calendar to help regulate agrarian work through proper use of ritual and music and create a rudimentary government. The annals of the bamboo book makes it clear, and I quote, that Yao, he united and harmonized the myriad states of his dominion, and the Li Men, black people, were reformed by his cordial agreement. We also read that Shun, the successor of Yao, distinguished by his reputation as an obedient, devoted son, noted too, and I quote, key, that the black people are suffering the distress of hunger, unquote. To help relieve the people, Shun gave his throne over to Yup, the founder of the Shang dynasty. Yup, in the annals of the bamboo books, is reported to have noted that, and I quote, when a sovereign gives response to the people, he is kind, and the black people cherish him in their heart. Very important to understand, you see, is that a black king, a black emperor is supposed to have a relationship with the people. But he not only in a sense has a relationship with the people, he also in a sense has a relationship with the land, because it's the land that allows the people to thrive. It's the land that allows the people to survive. And so then therefore we see this constant association of the pharaoh, the emperor, the king, the governor with the land. Because see, the land, the people, we're all considered one. Mark Washington has done many great photos of ancient China. You know, Mark, he lives over in Hungary today, and he did some very beautiful research in terms of the black, the African origin, and many Chinese. Here's one of his one of the things that he's done, and we can look in a sense and see some of the various artifacts that he found that show you know the identity of the various Chinese people as Li Men, you see. And many of these come from this figure, this bronze vessel. And you know, it makes it very interesting is that if you could see this bronze vessel, the various characters, look how small these characters are, but you can see detailed facial features. I think that's what makes in a sense the art of black people so interesting, is that they can make these tiny figures. And these tiny figures could have distinctive faces, you see. And this is to me a magnificent aspect of that work. Here's some more work by Mark. You know, again, he looks at some of the chariots. He looks at some of the black people, and these basically are people related to what's called the Shang civilization.
Okay, so what people founded the Shang dynasty, Doc?
Good question. The Chinese dynasty were founded by diverse ethnic groups, Xi and Shang-Yi. Shang-Yi, that's the Black Xi, Black Shang, were founded by Tamil and Mandarin speakers. Yes, you know, for some reason, the Tamil people that we find in India today and the Mandarin, they kind of go around. They in a way, they migrated to certain areas, Mesopotamia, China, India. So that's one of the reasons why you find a very close relationship between Tamil, which is spoken by Indian people, and the Mandarin language. For example, Kamala Harris, even though she wants to be white, you know, she's a Tamil, and her ancestors, in a sense, had a very good relationship. But she's also a Brahmin, and the Brahmins, in a sense, the Brahmins have a lot of influence from North India. Because see, a lot of the Brahmins, in a sense, you know, as some of the southern kingdoms went into decline, many of the Brahmins came from North India, and you also see that there's not always a close relationship between the Brahmins because of their North Indian heritage and the people in South India. But again, in a sense, the Tamil and Mandi languages share a lot of cognate words or words that have identical meaning and sayings. The Dravidian founders of Yin Shang. See, there was two Shang empires. There was the Yin Shang, that was the empire founded by, in a sense, Black people, and the last of the and the Anyang Shang and the Anyang were mainly, in a sense, the people that we call like the Vietnamese and other smallish kind of Black people, Polynesian, I mean, Asian people, like in Vietnam, you know, the Philippines and places like that. The most important culture in Chinese history is the Shang or Yin dynasty. The Shang culture was founded by the Yi tribes. Both the Yi and Yuek tribes, according to Professor Xun Xiang Lin, were Blacks. Fu Xun Yang and the Yi Yang Xu Yang Xuan makes it clear that the Shang culture bears remained allied to the rest of the Yi people who originally lived in southern China. The earliest Shang capital was located at Jingzhou. There were 30 kings of the Shang dynasties. The last 14 kings reigned at Anyang, Henan, in the Yellow River Valley. Again, the Anyang Shang were, as I told you before, mainly in a sense what we would call, in a sense, the original Mongoloid people, you know, who were short, as opposed to the taller Mongoloid people like that live in China today. The Yin Shang area during the Shang period, there were two harvests of millet and rice. There were also elephants and rhinoceros in the area, according to the oracle records. During the Shang period, the Tamil and Mandi rulers of the dynasty wrote much information on bones and turtle shells. This form of writing is called oracle bone writing. The modern Chinese are descendants of the Hua tribes that founded the Zhao. The second Shang dynasty, situated at Anyang, was founded by the Yin. As a result, this dynasty is called Shang Yin. The Yin Oceanic Mongoloid type is associated with the Austronesian speakers. During the Anyang Shang period, the Qiang lived in Xiangfang, a country to the west of the Yin Shang. The Qiang people were often referred to as the Da Qiang, Mini Qiang. They were used as agricultural workers and used in Shang Yi ancestral rites and sacrifice victims. This is very, very interesting. Is that you know, both the Shang Yi or the Mongoloid people and the Zhao dynasty, whenever they would have a celebration, they would go out and they would capture some Qiang. And the Qiangs were Black people, and just like how white people in the South used to like to hang and barbecue and Black people on holidays, that's what they did. That's what these Mongoloid people did too. The Shang, the Mongoloid Shang, and in a sense, the Mongoloid Zhao Hua tribes. Whenever it was a holiday, they would go and find some Qiang or Black people, and they would just, you know, burn them to the stake, and they felt that was a sacrifice. For some reason, Mongoloid and European people have always felt that if they could kill a Black person, that somehow that would bring them luck. I don't know why, but that's part of their culture. After the fall of the Yin Shang, many Tamils of North China took their ships and began to search the Pacific for new homelands. Many other Pacific islands, as far as Japan, were occupied by Proto-Dravidian-speaking people by 1000 BC. Thus, the classical Mongoloids mainly settled the Philippines and Indonesia, which was sparsely populated by Negro and Negrito tribes after the fall of the first Shang Empire. As I told before, like, there's a lot of traditions when you find the short Mongoloid people, like the people in Vietnam and other places where you find short Vietnamese people. These people in the anthropological literature are called classical Mongoloids, as opposed to the Hua or the tall Mongoloid people that live in China today. And if you notice, you hear in the news a lot about Taiwan, and even on Taiwan, the contemporary people who lived there, they will tell you that the original people who lived on Taiwan were Black people, you know, just an aside. The Mandi term Xi corresponds to the Chinese term Zhi, applied to the founders of the Xia dynasty. Xia was the first dynasty of ancient China, China's mother civilization. So here you can see the Chinese sign for Zi or Xi, which means Black. Gongwenji, or ancient Chinese script. Here we see an oracle bone inscription, and you can look on the right hand side. And if you look carefully, you can see that these, the inscription on the right-hand side, show that they're identical to writings that were already used in Africa, the Mandi people, the Bai people. Because again, as I told you, is that to understand the relationship between the Elamite civilization, the Sumerian civilization, the Shia civilization, and Shang, you have to look at the fact is that these people, they came from Africa originally and they settled. One of the reasons that many of them it came into Africa, went into Asia at this time, is that prior to the Great Flood, and you know, a lot of people talk about the Great Flood, I think even the Bible talks about it. Well, there was a Great Flood, and when this Great Flood came, this Great Flood destroyed many of the cities that were centers of civilization built by what we call the Anu people. And the Anu people are the pygmy people. And these Anu people, they had a great civilization, you know, beginning around 15,000 BC, and it lasted really up until around 4,000 BC. And when the last great flood occurred, and you know, because there was a flood in 10,000 BC during the Younger Dryas, but it was a flood around 4,000 BC that really destroyed many of the Anu centers. And so what happened is that the black people, the taller black people who lived in Africa, you know, who later founded the Sumerian, the Shia, the Indus Valley civilization, they had set out from Africa to resettle those places that the Anu had formerly ruled so they could get back those trading links that brought various minerals, you know, and precious jewels that they could bring those from Asia back to Africa. And so that's why, in a sense, there was this mass, you know, migration of black people from Africa into Asia to resettle many of the centers that had been founded by the Anu people. Here you can see again some of the writing of the Shia people. This is an oracle bone inscription. And you can see the Suan on the right hand side, you can see the various relationships. Like if you look at that that picture on the left hand side, it's a comparison of writing systems. And here you can see on the type line, you can see the oracle bone inscriptions. Then you can see the Mandean script. And if you look at this, look at these signs, you can see that the same signs that we find on the oracle bone writing, we also find on the Mandean of Bai script. And as I told you earlier, we find that the Shia in China, they had the same, in a sense, the same clan, the Kunta clan, and they had the Su clan, or the Su was a dynastic people, in a sense, that founded. They were, in a sense, the rulers. And as you can see on this left-hand side, this close relationship between these writing systems. Yes, yes, yes. Very important to understand. We are a literate people. We've not always just been oral people. We also, spent considerable time writing these inscriptions. You see, Europeans always talk about they can't read them. The reason they can't read them is they refuse to deal with the ancients. Our ancestors left us a blueprint to read these languages. But the Europeans, because of the fact that they always say that black people were too dumb to have writing, that black people didn't have a civilization, that black people have always been only slaves, they ignore, in a sense, the research that could help them to find this. But they don't really want to find this. They don't really want to prove this. Because when you know and you prove it, then that shows that you've been taught a lie. The Shi and Shang did not write in fanciful signs like the Jia Guwen script. The Guwen Jie, or ancient script of the Shang and Shia, was called Jiang Guwen, the oracle or divinatory writing. It was incised on hard materials like bone and shells. The writing of these people was a phonetic script. Yes, a phonetic script. They were syllabic signs, and using, in a sense, each sign represented a single word. And when you combine the signs, that meant in the sense that you put different syllables, you had different monosyllabic words that gave you a variety of meanings. But see, single signs represented one word. When you have signs put together, that could in a sense represent, you know, a group of words put together. Or it could represent names and other things. Again, here's the example of the various writing systems, and how the oracle bone writing relates to the writing used by the Mandi or Mandean people who founded a civilization in China. In the Chinese literature, the blacks were called Li Min, Kun Long, Qian, Qian, Yi, and Yue. The founders of the Xia dynasty and the Shang dynasties were blacks. These blacks were called Yuek and Qiang, Qiang. The modern Chinese are descendants of the Zhao or Han people. See, so you had to understand the original Chinese were called Li Min. The people who occupy China today, they're descendants of the Zhao and the Han people, Hua tribes. To understand the history of blacks in China, you need to learn the Chinese language. The Zhao recognized the founders of the first civilization in China, Xi and Shang, as Li Min, black people. Let's look at these words beginning with Min. The term Min equal people. Here we have in the word yo, and this is the Chinese symbols for black, yo. Here we have another symbol for black. This is yi. And this means black. And this is a Chinese symbol for that. And then we have ze, si, black. And as I told you, is that, you know, the X sign, as in zero, that sign is pronounced as a sh or s in English. So we find that ze, is the same as sick or black among the Mandy people. Ajiang and Mumbatik claim that the present-day Chinese represent the ancient Chinese. This is false. The present-day Chinese are descendants of the Han or Hua people. They are not Li Min. Li Min equal black people. Ajiang and Mumbatik are wrong. You see, the use of Li to denote Chinese tanned by the sun was the association of the Xiangxi characters with Li, the ancient designation of the original founders of Chinese civilization. They try to, in a sense, say that Xiangxi character relates to Li, and this is wrong. It's entirely wrong because Li and Xiangxi are two different characters. In Chinese, men, people, and Li, black. You can find this in L. Uyghur's Chinese characters. The Chinese classic make it clear that the Li Min meant black people, not young Chinese or peasant Chinese. Here you can see the definition from the Chinese dictionary. And you can see in a sense how Li means dark, blue, black, and then Min means the people and things like that. So it's not a lie, you see. Li Min means black people, but not the contemporary Chinese. You see, that's one of the reasons why the Chinese want to take control over their history, because they know that much of their history is based upon nothing but black people. Black people made Chinese. You know, in fact, in a sense, they always talk about the three dynasties. You know, the Xin Dai, you know, the Xia, the Shang, and the Zhao. When only the Zhao and the Anyang Shang are the only Mongoloid dynasties. The other dynasties of China, the original founders of Chinese civilization, were black people. Yes, black people like you, black people like me, black people like us. The term Li Min means black people, and this is very important in terms to understand. It has nothing to do with being tanned by the sun. Here we see Daoyang people. This means public masses. Means people, mean can mean people, mean people sprouts. Ren man, ren means man, person or people. Ren mean or people. Blacks and Chinese. You can see hair for black or dark. Heilong Xiang province abbreviated. He say black. So these are some of the various words that you'll find in Chinese that relate to black. Yes. They do not want you to know this. The Chinese, they want to pretend that they built that civilization in China. And it's a lie, they didn't build a civilization, you see? And in fact, and even when they talk about the fact that there's been a continuous line of emperors of China, that's a lie too. China was constantly being conquered by other people. The people coming from the north, they take over the Chinese, in a sense, rule of China. But see, when they would come in and they would take over, they wouldn't really try to mess with the Mandarin language. Because see, the Mandarin language, they always kept the Mandarin language as the Chinese state language. That meant, in a sense, is that if you wanted to work for the government in China, you had to know Mandarin, you see. And so even though these rulers would come from other parts of the north, other nomadic people would take over China, they always kept the Mandarin language. And this is how they kept a unity, in a sense, for the public administration and for the administrators. But there was not a continuous line of emperors in China. That's all bull. In later periods, many Chinese writers began to call the Tianjin character Li Min, so as to associate this sign with the ancient designation of the Shang and Xia people who were black. See, so again, in a sense, is that even though Tianjin relates to the people living there now, they wanted to associate with the character for Li Min so that they could, in a sense, have a history, you know, just like second frequency. The Chinese, like second frequency. They don't have a history, and so to give themselves an ancient history, they try to change things around. But there's so much documentation, so much literature related to ancient China that it's hard for them to really, in a sense, build up this lie and be able to perpetuate this lie if you look at the historical records. But they still, in a sense, want to maintain the myth that China was founded by Mongoloid people, when in reality, China was founded by black people. That's one of the reasons why the Chinese, they do not excavate the pyramid, the mounds. They found a lot of mounds in China, but they don't excavate those mounds because they're afraid to excavate those mounds because the stuff that they bring out will probably be of black people. And so then they made laws to make sure that nobody can excavate these mounds, so they can maintain this lie that China has always been a civilization ruled by Mongoloid people, and that black people had no role to play in China. Even today in modern China, sometimes they try to act like that black people are monkeys. You know, they make commercials showing black people being very poor in Africa and things like that. That's always, in a sense, to denigrate black people, to put black people down. When the scholars know, they know, in a sense, that the reason they have the civilization they have today, the reason they have the writing they have today, has nothing to do with Mongoloid people, but all to do with black people, African people. Here we can see, here's the characters for Li Min, or black people. These are the characters that you would find if you were reading a Chinese manuscript. You would see these characters referring back to the original people who lived in China, the Li Min. Some researchers maintain that the Chinese language has not changed over the past 4,000 years. This is false. Chinese scholars have long recognized that the phonology of Chinese has changed over time. The Fukienese scholar Ph.D recognized the discrepancies in the rhymes of verses from different ages and observed that, and I quote, "It is a natural principle that the script and the sound of the Chinese language differ according to time and place." Yes, yes, yes. See, that's one of the things they want to act like everything is just, it's copacetic. Everything has been stagnant. Everything has been constant. And this is wrong. There has been changes. And the dynamicism came in the fact that different nomadic groups would conquer China. And as these different nomadic groups would conquer China, they would, in a sense, sometimes change the orthography or the sound of some of the characters in the Chinese language. Some researchers maintain that the Chinese language has not changed over the past 4,000 years, but I told you it has. We also find changes between early written Chinese, Wenyan written language of Confucius time, and modern written Chinese. The Wenyan illustrates a terseness in the use of words as illustrated below. A sentence written in the Wenyan. Yu pang ye se yuan fei le bu yi le hu. You know, and this means, have friend from far places, come not also joy. And this is the literal meaning of it. But when you put it all together and you try to make it so that it's understandable in the English language, it's, if you have friends coming from far away, isn't also joy? Here we present the same sentence in modern Chinese. Ru gua, yu ping guan, yu gong yong feng, le bu xie, yin hua li ma. See? And so this is the same sentence, but as you can notice, it's different from the sentence that I read, you know, just a few minutes ago. So Chinese has changed, you see. But again, there's always what's called a diachronic and a synchronic, you see. A relationship that means an old and a modern relationship between languages, you see. And so, again, the Chinese language has been heavily influenced, again, by these various nomadic groups that have taken over China at various times in China's history.
You had to go plug. Get your glasses.
I had to go and plug the plug had come out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because it was saying that the battery's running low. I didn't want to be low.
All right.
So today the term ren is used for man. Ren, man. This sign is the radical sign for person. It is the plural sign from nouns and pronouns applied to people. For here we can see it in Jin. Ren men or people. This is how they would write modern Chinese ren men. If you notice, the screen is brightened up. To use Li Man to refer to the ancient Chinese is found in the Chinese classics. James Lang's in the Lays in the Chinese classics, published in 1865, provides examples of the use of Li Man in reference to the ancient Chinese. Although Li means black, Lang often translates this sign as black hair to attempt to disguise the African black ancestry of the founders of Chinese civilization. Yes. Even though men means people, they would try to translate it as black hair. Anything to try to throw people off. You know, Europeans, they spend all of their time trying to write us out of history. But when you research the history yourself, then you can find, in a sense, the truth. That's one of the reasons why I tried to learn how to read a lot of ancient languages back in the day so I could get to the real nitty gritty. In the Shu King, we read that, I quote, in the canon of Yao, we discover that Yue regulated and polished the people of his domain, who all became brightly intelligent. Finally, he united and harmonized the myriad states of the empire, and lo, the black people were transformed. In this passage, Li Men is used to describe all the people in the empire, not just the peasants or the young people. Because see, now, in a sense, they want to say that Li Men means peasants. Li Men means young people. No, Li Men means black people. But you would know this. If you went to China today, you would notice, because they're going to teach you this lie. See, you know, they're not just bad because they're communists. They're bad because they lie about their history. But come on now. Should I be mad at them? No. Should you be mad at them? No. Everybody wants to give themselves a history. Everybody wants to give themselves a way to say that they're somebody, you see. But it would be better, in a sense, not to just claim that you have a history that you don't have. You should at least tell the truth, you see. But the truth is far away from reality with Mongoloid people. It's far away from reality with second frequency, because these people, in a sense, they have no ancient history. Their ancient history is a history of barbarism. Their ancient history is nomadicism. That's why we always find they had the tent, you see. But it was a sedentary black people who built culture. It was a sedentary black people who built religion. It was a sedentary black people who built architecture. It was a sedentary black people who studied the stars and made the calendars. It was a sedentary black people who gave us civilization, culture, and everything that makes human beings have a well and satisfactory way of life. In book two, it was written that that Gao Yang, I quote, "with vigorous activity sowing abroad his virtue, which has descended on the black people, till they cherish him in their hearts." Again, the term Li Min was applied to the people of the empire, not just a particular group. In the Annals of the Bamboo Book, we learned that Yao devised a calendar to help regulate agrarian work through proper use of ritual and music, and created a rudimentary government. The Annals of the Bamboo Books make it clear that Yao, quote, "he united and harmonized the myriad states of his dominion, and the Li Min, black-headed people, were reformed by his cordial agreement." You see, that's one of the things, is that they want to make you believe, you know, the Chinese, modern Chinese, want to make you believe that they had all this rich culture. No, they didn't have that rich, this rich culture. You know, they rarely have that good music today. So they definitely didn't have good music in ancient times. That's one of the reasons why foundational black Americans, you know, their music is dominant around the country. You're saying, why the hell is Dr. Winters bringing up contemporary music? It's just to show that black people love music. And when we're in our natural state and not being, in a sense, confounded, not being, in a sense, totally put under the thumb of white people of second frequency, we have a creativity that nobody can touch. That's why one of our greatest musical geniuses and one of our greatest artistic geniuses is who? Yoshima, the genius. We also read that Shun, the successor of Yao, distinguished by his reputation as an obedient, devoted son, noted that, and I quote, key, that the black people are suffering the distress of hunger. Again, we see this use of Li Man or black people. To help relieve the people, Shun gave his throne over to Yue, the founder of the Shang dynasty. Yue, in the Annals of the Bamboo Books, is reported and noted that, and I quote, "when a sovereign gives response to the people, he is kind, and the black people cherish him in their heart." Isn't that so true? Isn't that so true? When we have good political leaders, we cherish them in our hearts. Like today, it's sad to say, but we have foundational black Americans. They don't have any good political leaders today. We have the congressional talkers, and they do nothing in Congress to help black people. Black people are the most frequently killed. Black people are the most are the ones to suffer the most from all this crime, from all this hate. And yet they don't even have an anti-hate bill for black people. They got one for Asians, and Asians had a rarest. According to statistics of the FBI, they have the lowest number of hate crimes. The majority of hate crimes are experienced by foundational black Americans, but we don't even have a hate crime bill. But why? You see, that's why we can't love our sovereigns like the people in ancient China did. They said, why? Because when a sovereign gives response to the people, he is kind, and the black people cherish him in their heart. We can't cherish those people, those are congressional talkers, the congressional black Congress, and why we can't cherish them for ish. Here's a picture of how the Shang dynasty was and where it was located in China. To understand the history of blacks in China, you need to learn the Chinese language. The Zhao recognized the founders of the first civilization in China, Xi and Shang, as Li Min, black people. See, Western researchers, when translating the ancient Chinese textual material relating to Shang and Xi, always mistranslate Li as black head or black hair. This is false. Dr. L. Wagner, in Chinese Characters, New York, Dover Publication, 1965, gives a translation of it as dark, doom color, black. As a result, instead of reading Li as dark hair, it should be read as black. Thus, Chinese characters, Li Min, black people. Yes, yes, yes. As I said before, second frequency is always trying to lie. They're always trying to steal history and write black people out of that history. The fact that Li Min means black people makes it clear that Western researchers mistranslate these Chinese characters, deny the history of black people in China. We must conclude that the Xi and Shang people referred to themselves as Li Min because they were black people, not because sunspots were referred to as black. The Mandi people of Africa claim they belong to the Sioux clan, just as the ancient Chinese or Xia said they belong to the Sioux clan. The Chinese culture hero Huang Di is a direct link to Africa. His name was pronounced in old Chinese as Yuai Huang Di, Huna Kunti. He was supposed to have arrived in China from the West in 2082 BC and settled along the banks of the Lu River in Shaanxi. If you want to find out more about the ancient blacks of China, get my book, The Ancient Blacks of China, and also Ancient Black Civilizations of Asia. Please join my Patreon. That's where you're going to find these slides. And so make sure, in a sense, to become a member of Patreon. Give me your support. Help to further this research. And thank you so much to my Patreon members. Thank you.
In the words of Sister Shanice, wow, wow, wow. That was incredible, beloved Baba. That was absolutely incredible. You know, no scholar has put black people back in their rightful place more than you. It's we talk about it all the time. We assume it all the time. But until we have that historical, empirical evidence that black people were the first, we are the first frequency, we are the first people, we populated the entire planet, but you give us the how it was done. It's, you know, I say this every freaking week, and obviously I've been saying it for the last 2 years now, going on three, that I don't know how you top yourself and do this work every week, but this was another one for the books community. You know, if there's such a thing as putting your hands together and giving this man a standing ovation, just flood the chat right now with B1, 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 because this is what black excellence looks like, family. This is it. You know, we are the best of the best. Thank you. Go ahead, Doc, please.
You know, I only learned about the Sioux Empire about 2 or 3 years ago when I read Lenny Srivastava's book. I wasn't able to connect all these Sioux to a civilization.
Wow.
I knew that the Sioux was the plural for the Mandy speaking people. So I knew that the Sioux were related, but I didn't know until I read her book that the 14th pharaoh of Egypt, Nehesi, was also the emperor of the Sioux Empire, and that all of these countries were part of a federated state. See,
and what you did was you showed continuity. That's what we, because everything is choppy, everything is broken up. You were able to show this level of continuity that we have not seen before. This is incredible.
Thank you, but it goes back. But it's only explained by Marie Charles and her first sight consciousness. You see, it's Marie Charles. See, you guys out there, family, you may think when you do research, you just look at names, you look at people, you look at this, you look at that. But see, what you learn is that you have to have a theoretical base. You have to have a theoretical foundation to be able to study. For example, I have the theoretical base that allows me to compare modern languages, modern African languages, with ancient languages spoken around the world, is because of anti-diops concept of linguistic continuity. In other words, in a sense, the languages change slower within African communities than they do in European communities. This is testified by the fact that when you study many of the words collected by the Arabs who traveled to the Muslim civilization of Male, Ghana, you find that many of those words they recorded are pronounced and have the same meaning today that they had almost 1,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
That shows the relationship. And so then one of the ways that we can look at these Black civilizations, what that gives us a theoretical base, is Professor Marie Charles' idea of the first sight consciousness, in the sense of that is that we have a continuity in civilizations that go back to the earliest Black civilizations, but it's only explained when you understand Marie Charles' ideas about this unity of civilization. And so that's why we need researchers who develop, in a sense, very good theoretical bases. Sister Shanice, what Sister Shanice has done is that she's been concentrating on in a sense, you know, the Irish origin of many Jamaicans. And what she noted, in a sense, is that she found that some of the way that some Jamaicans speak English is related to how Irish is spoken. And, you know, this is a concept that needs mm-hmm. further research. But again, it's developing these theoretical bases, it's developing these ideas. And another thing about this whole idea of Nahisse, Pharaoh Nahisse of the 14th dynasty, being the emperor of the Sioux dynasty, this also tells us what? It also tells us that we assume that Europeans have told us all of Egyptian history. They haven't told us all of Egyptian history. And see, and we're never going to know as much as we need to know about Egyptian history until Black scholars
to redo it.
Look at this history and redo it. Yes, because see, you're going to look at it from a different light. Many other things, in a sense, see, you know, second frequency has left many things out of their historical studies of various aspects of ancient peoples, because of the fact is that they don't want you to get any inkling to understand that these people were Black like you, that these mm-hmm. Blacks spread a Black culture. And so then, therefore, in a sense, there's little tidbits that you may read in a research study, you may read from an archaeological study, that could lead you on a path to get a greater understanding of the history of the Kemenchu or the Kemiu, the Blacks of Egypt. But see, you'll never get that if you're waiting for second frequency. If you're waiting for these strangers, these settlers, these Arabs who control Egypt today, if you're waiting for second frequency or these Arabs that control Egypt today to tell you the truth about Egyptian history, you're never going to get it.
Never going to get it.
They want
it, it's what, well, isn't it what you said? I mean, I thought that was fascinating as well. They don't do any excavations in China with the mounds, because they basically figured they probably did at some point and found that it was nothing but Black people. And so they wanted to completely take that out of their history.
And they made it against the law, you know.
Wow.
And see, that's one of the reasons why I'm working on a book now that I'm going to bring out in January or December. It's going to be on the Aboriginal Americans, when I'm going to talk about, in a sense, the Aboriginal civilization. You know, a lot of people over here, they want to say, in a sense, that America is, that America is the old world, and that this is a, no. In this book, I'm going to show you the Aboriginal civilization that we had. Some of this we've already talked, in some of the shows we did. Remember, we did 3 shows on the Aboriginal Blacks. But this book is going to be a more detailed account of it. Just like today, you find a lot of Aboriginals that they're so proud to say, "I'm not African, I'm not Black, you know, I'm Niji, dumbass." Niji is the Mandi word, in a sense, for hello, good morning. It's a greeting that males used to use back in the day. And then people say, "Dr. Winters, you're full of shit." No, because I can show you how the main people, in a sense, who created the lingua franca that the 5 civilized tribes used, they were called the Mandi. See, but because of the fact that these people, sadly, are people who do not do research. You know, that's one of the reasons why we've been trying to develop these researchers, that we're trying to develop people. Look at the research you're doing. But we need people, in a sense, who are doing the research to tell our history. as prisoners of war. They're not going to let the prisoners of war take over the jail. Get out of here.
Now, this book coming out, that's going to be what, like number 45?
That'll be somewhere around there.
I can't catch up with you at all. I don't know what to do. I'm only at 20-something. I can't keep up.
It don't matter the way you're going. You're going to pass me up. You're younger than me. I'll be dead, and you'll be still right. Whoa, turn them out.
Oh, my gosh. The library, the catalog that you have, beloved, is mind-boggling. It's staggering. It really is. You know, and I am, I'm just so proud of you. I'm so proud and honored. You know, what did I do right to get a Dr. Clyde Winters in my life? You know, I must have tithed at some church somewhere. I did something. I must have said something. I don't know what it is. PJ, what do you think it is? I don't know, but I'm so glad that our paths crossed because, and that we saw each other. You know, part of that B1 consciousness, part of that first sight consciousness is being able to see each other and not compete with one another, but converse and complement one another. And that's what we're doing. So I'm just so honored and floored.
But you know what created this connection was that David Imhotep, when we were trying to publicize this book. And it was David Imhotep, you know, he brought us together when we talked, because you were nice enough to do, you did a show on my book, We Are Not Just Africans. And it was Abba and David, and you guys.
I remember that. Okay.
Yeah, because that was how, and then later.
That was years ago.
Yeah, then later, remember when he made his new edition, then you said, well, Clyde, will you come on to talk about that? And that's when I tell you how important your research was and how people was really in the same line, not to trying to block. And you were surprised because I was able to tie first, second frequency into the historical drama. And you said, damn, nobody else did that. And you said you had Kaba, what's his name? All those people, you know, Smalls, and none of them could really see the genius. And see, it's really a shame, but that's just to show. That's to show how our so-called black scholars are not really scholars. That they couldn't recognize your genius and recognize the fact that you was bringing out aspects of our culture by being, in a sense, the type of person who created. And you are the man who created the only black think tank. It's a digital think tank, but you're the only one to create a black think tank, because you brought on all the leading black scholars, black researchers who wrote a lot, who wrote interesting stuff about our history, our culture, our psychology, sociology, you know, pathology, and even medicine with Elaine, you know. So then the thing is, this is that you have to be credited. Thank you for talking about my books, but you had to be credited by this digital black think tank. There's no other black think tank on the planet Earth, you know, and it's sad to say. And just think, family, if we had some black millionaires who really cared about us as a people, who really cared about our history, and who really wanted us to be successful, just think if they would give, you know, Dr. Shaka $1 million or me $1 million. To have the time to do the research and go get the real sources. Can you imagine what we could turn out?
Oh, see, my God. I would be in the stacks. I would be in every library.
Right.
I would be back this just getting it all. Are you kidding me? Oh, my goodness.
And see that's the beauty of it, just like the Oriental Institute at the University of Chicago. You know, he was able to build that because he was able to go and sell these white, he was able to tell these white folks, you know, the founder of the Oriental Institute, that it was some black-skinned whites who built Nubia, because he did most of his research in Nubia. And they financed it. See, they financed it. You got to give them credit. You know, sure, it was a lie. They weren't black-skinned whites. They was just black-skinned blacks.
Right.
He told them that they were black-skinned whites, and they gave him millions of dollars. You know, And then it is so
think strange. About how insane that just hear the words black skin whites. What?
Yeah. And you know, Turok, he's a German guy, and he wrote a book as late as the 2000s, the early 2000s, still saying the Nubians, the Kushites, were black skin whites. But the thing is, just think of this family. Now you think about this family. As I told you, the Cook brothers have given millions of dollars to these white think tanks to be able to vilify us, to be able to build up these amendments to take away our right to vote, our right for representation. You know, giving money to these organizations to take away the ability of black people to get jobs,
mm-hmm.
and things like that, and how they did this and to get rid of abortion. And just think about this. Can you imagine the time and money that Reverend Dr. Schock spent to bring all those people on his innocence, on his black think tank, his platform? Can you imagine how much money I've spent over the years that I should have been buying my kids some maybe some peppers and some damn formula? But I'll admit that we didn't give our babies milk formula, Infamil and all that. We did like what my mama did for us. We gave them carnation milk and water.
And they came out phenomenal.
It helped Doc Shock. So that's what we did instead of infamil shit. So I had to, that saving of that money helped me to research for those 40 books. But again, what I'm saying is that it's just sad Oprah Winfrey and all these black athletes spend all their money on some white thighs and child support for all these babies. Explain to me how you're a millionaire and you know that the only way women can get
multimillionaire.
Multimillionaire. Yeah. But the only way women can get money from you is to have your baby. And you're a millionaire basketball player, football player, and you don't wear a prophylactic, a rubber. Explain that to me. That is the silliest thing in the world to me. And yet, that's what these people do. But they don't want to give money to Dr. Schock or to me to do research.
I want to thank all of my Patreon members now, but some of y'all. I want y'all to go and become Patreon member. I don't usually promote my Patreon. I want y'all to come and become a Patreon member. I got some hellified research up in there. So thank you very much. Yes, yeah. Get your butts over there and click on that Patreon link in the description and support both of us, Dr. Clyde Winters and myself.
That's right.
Because you can't get this information anywhere else.
Yeah.
And this
money coming out of our pocket.
Yeah.
Yes, and it's a sacrifice. It's a sacrifice. You see?
You know, I think it's one of those things too, Doc, that, you know, and I know it's going to probably sound cliche a little bit, but this is something that we, in a sense, that even if we didn't have money, we would still do this work for free.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because we love it so much. It's a part of it's part of our DNA. So it's like it wouldn't be a million. You give us $1 million and then, you know, we I don't know what the hell. You go to Disneyland or such. I don't give a shit about Disneyland. So I would just go deeper into research, launch research forums around the world, collaborate, create that black intelligentsia, create institutions so that we can have our own research so that as our Amu population begins to thin, we have the scientists in place to be able to move the black planet forward. That's right. Where I'm coming from, you know, it is what it is.
You know, because see, the thing is that it's coming. It's coming. You know, it is coming. Just like the Anu, I always talk about the Anu civilization. Mm-hmm. They all knew they built their cities right next to lakes, rivers, and streams, and near the ocean. And then when that water rose around 4000 BC, it wiped their shit out. It wiped them out. Yeah. You know, they said that the shoreline in Australia is now I think they said about 100 miles less than it was, you know, before the last flood.
Wow.
That means all that civilization stuff. You know, in Japan, they found an underwater city. And the symbols on the inscriptions from that underwater city are the same inscriptions that the Anu used, you know, in Göbekli Tepe, you know. And see what I'm saying is that it is so much knowledge out there. And just think what you could do, Reverend Matthews and myself. Just think about the fact that you see an article and it's a real nice abstract. And then when you say click on the article, and then it say $150 to read it. $150 to read the damn paper for 2 days.
That I just saw that I wanted to get, because it's the research I'm doing for my next book. The book costs $200 on Amazon. They don't want you to have this information.
Yeah. See, just like when you read a genetic article, when you read genetic articles, and they have these open journals or these journals that are online, like PLOS and Dateline Genetics and stuff. Then you say, wow, hey, this stuff is online. This stuff is free.
That's the bullshit.
That's right.
Yeah, they're giving it away for free so they can deceive you. That's the deception. The real shit is behind the paywall.
That's right. But no, and some of their stuff is good online. But let me tell you, those people who have that article published in an online journal, if you go to the editorial page, it'll tell you that most of the time you had to pay somewhere between $3,000 and $5,000 for them to publish your article. Yep. So what if it's online? So what if it's free? That person paid $4,000 or $5,000 for it. But see, that's because they can do that, because when these people get a grant from the federal government, when they get a grant from the Science League, they usually get a grant. Part of that grant you write up for the publication cost, as much as $10,000. Nothing is free. Nothing is free. See,
right.
and so when we
all
do,
we ask it is $5 a month. Shit, yeah. You know, that's, you know, and that? People can't do that. It's crazy, man.
$5 a month, and you know, and the thing is, this is that. I mean, that's less.
But we're also supposed to be talking about Ma'at all the time. We're the first to talk about Ma'at reciprocity, and where is it?
Yeah,
you know, where is it? Come on, man. Let's keep it real.
These same people, they go to Starbucks and they spend at least $30 a week on coffee.
At least, minimum.
You know, caramel macchiato, granny.
That's my ish.
No, that's what my wife used to like, was caramel macchiato, venti caramel macchiato. You know, and so when
I love caramel macchiato.
That's about $5.
Yeah.
Easily.
You know? Easily.
Yeah. Right. And the thing is this, though, is that what I'm saying is that they're hiding the knowledge from us, but it's hidden in plain sight.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Dr. Winters. It's hidden in plain sight. Just like that book that Reverend Dr. Matthews saw that was costing all that money. It's right there. There's the evidence that Mike could shine light on something you're doing research on. But that money makes it so. Is it really worth it? Am I going to spend $200 to get that book when my wife might need some medicine or I might need my job fixed?
Sure.
They've said on the news right now, they said that the price of getting your car fixed is 20% higher this year than it was last year.
I told you when we got the we have an X3 BMW, and the radiator went out, and it was something else. Anyway, $7,000 later is what it took to get that puppy fixed. And it's like, maybe we should get a Ford. Shit, I'm just saying. God damn. Yeah. But yeah. It's like they this is how they X you out. Yeah. Of trying to, they don't want you to thrive. They want you to survive. They want you to revolve, not evolve. And I'm saying F that. It's time for us to live our greatest existence right now, not after we die, go to heaven, all that bullshit that you go to glory. No, we should have glory while we are living. Yeah. And I'm tired of that ish, man. I'm tired of that. And I'm tired of all of these preachers taking all the money from the community. They're living well. Meanwhile, their congregations can't keep the damn lights on.
That's right.
What the fuck is that about?
That's right. You know, that's right. And it's pathetic, you know, just like now, you know, black people in America, they usually built their houses on stilts, or they built them on the top of mounds. Now, if you've been noticing, a lot of people don't know America. America's a tricky ass country. It's a tricky ass country. What I mean by that is that it can give you decades of beautiful weather, decades of places where you can live fine. But if you notice, look at all these floods that's in Connecticut.
Yeah,
these floods in California. These floods, look at the floods out west. You know, the flooding out west and stuff, even in Vegas and all that. See, now we see what the genius of the black Indians. The black Indians, they built their houses up on mounds. You know, what them niggas living up there for? Now you see why they was living on mounds, because they know that sometimes it's floods. Sometimes, in a sense, the water gonna come up, and if your house is on a mound, then it's not gonna be flooded. You know,
right?
I grew up. I forgot 92, 91. I was doing the Clinton administration. My first house, you know, it got flooded. Like right now in Chicago. Chicago had a lot of bad floods. Not much on the south side this time, but on the west side, you know. And I had to get a loan from the small business administration to fix my house back up, you know, because it was flooded. And see, that's the whole point. But see, the thing is, this is that. Is that
you remember when there was a flood in Chicago and it was Marshall Fields and all the State Street and everything? Everything got, you remember that? That was crazy.
See,
basements of all the department stores and everything were completely flooded.
That's because it's a sign. It's a sign. See, that's why. I have some of my books are digital, but that's why I have, in a sense, a lot of my books are also published in paperback and now hardcover. Because see, the writing is on the wall. The writing is on the wall. That once that magnetic pulse hit, once those floods, they're not going to be able to recover that information from those computers. But if they got a hard copy, or a paper copy of, you know, the Jedi, they can still maybe reconstruct that shit. Because, see, Europeans, look, think about how many times in history Europeans have lost writing.
That's true. Facts.
They always lose it.
Facts.
Because it's not in their nature. Mm-hmm. They always lose shit. They always lose their intelligence. No, I'm serious, you know.
No, I know you are. I'm just laughing because I didn't think about it, but you're absolutely on point.
Right. That's right. And see, it's so, but we're able to reconstruct, we're able to build it up. And so then, but see, just like now, you go to a car dealership, it ain't no car, no more cars. You got to order the car sight unseen. You got to order the car because they don't have no cars on the lot. Why? Because Biden say you can't buy chips from China.
Insane.
It's insane. And now China, all of what Trump and Biden did to try to keep the Chinese from, now the Chinese have made a chip, the 5G chip, and they moving to the 10G chip. See, you can't stop them. You can't stop people. Once you let the cat out the bag, man.
Can't stop innovation.
That's right. And because of the fact that they want us to be just athletes, and they want us to be just bubble rappers, then we're not, you know, our young people aren't really
interested. We're the first to perish. We're going to be first to perish.
That's right.
We're going to be first to perish. That's why one of the research gaps that I'm in is the digital divide.
Yeah.
And technology. It's like if you don't have, if you're not teaching your kids technology and how to either have jobs in the future or create their own career, your family's going to become extinct.
Right, because football and basketball, that ain't going to last. How long are people going to keep on paying $75 for a ticket for one little football game, basketball?
Come on.
All that type of shit.
That's crazy.
Right, but see, if they get your book, AI Jedi, if they get that Artificial Intelligence Jedi, that's going to help their kids to learn something new. If they get my book, A Guide to Setting Up a Homeschool, that'll show you how to set up the homeschool. Yep. That'll show you in a sense of things you need to know.
We need our own universities in our homes first.
Right. In our homes. That's what I love about this. Help set it up. And then you get my guide on how to set up your homeschool. Shit, and then you go and get Dr. Shark's book talking how your kid can use that artificial intelligence.
I'm trying to tell people.
You have made an unfair advantage.
Yep.
Roger.
Yep. That's it. Well, on that note, doggone it, we're going to just close ourselves out with our affirmation of power.
It's not too long anyway.
No, it's never too long, bro. Never too long. No, I could go hours, and I think the family would be right there with us. We'll be eating dinner and stuff, sipping our sippy cup. Sitting here watching me and Clyde. Oh, man, I love it. Exactly. So, family, let's take a moment of silence and let's prepare for our appointment with Amo and our ancestors. And let's give honks to this amazing knowledge that Dr. Clyde Winters has been chosen by Amo to do this work, to research this work for over 51 years. He has been anointed. He has been chosen, the chosen one, to do this work, to make known the unknown, to make visible the invisible. We give thanks. And in the name, nature, and consciousness of Amo, we say, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
So it is.
Love you, family.